people messaging me privately, very successful people messaging me with their own stories saying, I grew up like this too. This is where I am now. This happened to me too. This is where I am now. And I was just shocked at the number of private messages I got from people that this resonated with.
Welcome to Business and Inclusion, a podcast by TRIAC. Who's TRIAC? We're the Toronto Region Immigrant Employment Council. What does that mean? We work to champion the skills and talents of newcomers and build immigrant-inclusive workplaces, because we believe when immigrants prosper, the region prospers. On the pod, we'll bring you topics that affect the region's employers and its increasingly diverse workforce.
Hi, podcast listeners. I'm Danielle Chen.
And I'm Chidimma Eghagha. And we'll be your hosts for today's episode of Business of Inclusion. In today's episode, we'll be sharing our conversation with Camille Dundas. Camille is a career journalist turned social storyteller who consults for branding as well as diversity, equity, and inclusion. She is the co-founder and editor-in-chief of ByBlacks.com, an online magazine dedicated to Black Canadian culture, business, and news, and has been named one of the top 100 accomplished Black women in Canada.
We thought it was important to know that we sat down for this chat with Camille a few weeks ago. And in light of the pain our friends and colleagues in the Black community were going through, we decided to hold the episode back to ensure important conversations about Black and Indigenous lives and safety were receiving the urgent attention that is needed.
But it's a great and joyful conversation and also touches a lot on the small ways systematic racism affects our day-to-day life as professionals, especially women. So we're happy to share it with you today. If you're a Black woman or a woman of color, we hope you feel seen. And if not, we hope you listen and learn.
Welcome, Camille.
Thank you very much.
I'd love to start by talking about something I'm really passionate about, personal branding. Not long ago, I did a presentation, Brand for Success, for members of TRIAC Professional Immigrant Networks at ENY Downtown Office. I share some key points about this topic. I think it's even more important now because we're living in this historic era full of uncertainties. We start to see people lose jobs. We see jobless rate is going up. None of the supply chain is planned for to manage this pandemic. Now we're working from home and it's more important now to network and to take our own life into our own hand. And I think it's particularly important for immigrant Korean people, including women, to take their personal branding more seriously than ever. What are you known for? What is your domain? After all, personal branding is about people talk about you when you're not in the room. So Camille, it would be great to hear from you on maintaining professionalism and a personal branding in the time of COVID-19. What is your story about personal branding and what do you think is important to consider?
I think it's important to consider the things that you considered before COVID, I think are still the same things you're going to consider after, during COVID. Yes. With your personal brand online. I think there's a temptation to maybe veer away from what you're known for online, because I think right now emotions are getting the better of a lot of us. And so what I've observed is a lot of people kind of, you know, like ranting or talking about like just their frustrations. And that can work if that has been your brand online all along. So if you've been known for someone who talks about their life, who, you know, talks about everything they're going through day to day, if that's what your audience has become known, then continue with that. Personally, so I am very active on LinkedIn professionally, right? And I did not post anything on LinkedIn until, I believe, the third or fourth week into our quarantine. And I didn't feel bad about that. I didn't feel any ways about that because I had a quick conversation in my head going something like, okay, you can start commenting on everything that's going on. Or you can make sure that the messages that you put out are consistent with the messages you've been putting out all the time. And I'm known on LinkedIn for speaking about diversity and equity and inclusion. And so I knew whatever I posted would have to be related to that somehow. And so I continued to look for the opportunities around this discussion about equity and say, okay, what is it that people aren't talking about when they're talking about COVID? What conversations are they missing when it comes to how this ties into equity? Because the conversation is so large and so overwhelming that it gets, these concerns get really lost in the shuffle sometimes. And there was a bit of conversation going around, you know, referring to COVID as the great equalizer and this and that, and we're all in the same boat. And I ended up writing a post that had a line in it that said, we may all be in the same boat, but we're each paddling with different sized oars.
Hmm.
And, you know, a lot of people picked up on that and shared that because it resonated with what a lot of people were feeling, but couldn't emote, you know? And so, but I waited for that to come to me. You know what I mean? I didn't force that. I didn't say, okay, well, I have to write something about equity today. You know, I just waited until I just observed, and then I soaked it in, and then that was what I put out. So in short, it's really about staying true to what it is that you talk about, what it is that you know and feel, and staying in that stream.
Great. Thank you for sharing that. Stay focused and then to maintain the core value of yourself.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I like that you highlighted the importance of us being consistent to who we are and our brand, even at this time. And I like how you talk about what you wrote. And one of the articles you wrote that was also of interest to me was your article on how you're surviving your new coworkers, that is your kids. Yes. So I think that we are all managing to achieve some form of normalcy to varying degrees of success as we work from home. Mm-hmm. Personally, as a mother with three kids, I found transitioning to working from home with my kids and their dad was definitely not a walk in the park for me. Yes, it did come with a host of challenges. And, you know, just from managing different waking up times to getting the kids to understand that when I'm on the phone, I'm not necessarily having a chat with a friend. I'm actually working and I need the time. And also just getting them to understand that even though mommy's at home, she's not on vacation. She needs to have some uninterrupted work time.
Yeah.
So going to your article, I'm curious to know how you've managed working from home and parenting, including the e-learning challenge, because that's a very big one for me. Yes.
Massive. So, like, what is so crazy about that article is that, and it was for CBC, they asked me to write it, and I wrote it in the first week of the lockdown, right? I wrote it in the first week, but it didn't get published until the third week. And when they published it in the third week, I was like, oh, no, take it down because so much has changed. Like, my first week was radically different from the third week. And I had to ask them to take it down quickly and rewrite the first half of it because it was everything had changed. Yeah. And it just kind of struck me, like, how quickly, like, this stuff. And mm-hmm. I have to be honest with you, like, half the things, like, the tips I put in there, like, I can't even follow right now. Like, I'm not even following my own advice that I wrote in the article. Honest to God, because things change week to week. People see the article, be like, "Oh yeah, I used that tip. It was so great." I'm like, "Wonderful! I'm not doing that anymore." But if it works for you, cool.
Yes,
because I'm just trying to survive from day to day, and it changes every day. Like the hardest thing is keeping like whatever it is I'm doing, like keeping that consistent and doing that every day. The e-learning has really. Especially, so I have two kids, one's 8 and one's 4.
Mm-hmm.
4-year-old, they kind of just send like little activities. I've done one activity out of the dozens that they've sent because it requires 100% of my time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then I have the 8-year-old who doesn't require 100% of my time necessarily, but I need to ensure that he's actually doing the work. Because if I don't sit there for the 3 hours, he's gonna just go off and start playing his games or whatever, right?
So, yeah.
It showed me different sides of his personality that I didn't have the chance to observe before that have proven to be massive challenges for how I parent him.
Yeah, I'm sure you'll figure it out. Like you got a couple of months to think about it and then you'll figure out something, yes.
Yeah.
That's the superpower I feel moms have. Like, you think of something once you send your mind to it. I'm pretty sure about that.
Yeah.
So one of the things that has come up with working from home is the whole video conferencing, video call thing. And a lot of women that I know are currently facing a challenge with what I would call the politics of a video call. You know, the politics to dial in and show your face, put an extra burden of having to put yourself all together. So for me, it's a tricky one, especially because I'm a team lead. And sometimes I feel like there is a necessity to see people's faces just so that you can perhaps get a better assessment of cues. Like when you talk about things like mental health and things like that. So when I'm having like a one-on-one with my team members, I just feel like if I'm able to see their faces, I'll be able to also have a better assessment of how well they're doing or where I need to help out. So I'd like to know what your take is on this. Camera on or camera off?
So, what I'll admit is that I struggled. So I work from home 90% of the time anyways, right? And I struggled day to day, not with working from home. I love working from home. But just in general, before COVID-19, I struggled with my sleep patterns. I struggled with stress and anxiety over the kids, like freaking out over what they're doing, et cetera. Dividing my time. Before COVID, I traveled extensively for my job. So I was away from the kids a lot of time, right? I traveled, it was like 60% travel, 40% at home, okay? And so my schedule is always up and down. I struggle with sleep. And so that informs my stress level and mental health challenges, right? Of just being able to wake up and face the day. So I love the fact that I never turned my camera on, because I would have conversations from underneath my duvet, literally, right? I would like conducting meetings from underneath my cover. Because that's what I needed to do to make it through the day. And I literally sometimes would like set my alarm for like 10:59 if my meeting's at 11. And I would roll out and just do the meeting with after 1 minute after waking up. So the thought of having to turn my camera on now, and I feel like men are the ones coming up with these great ideas. because like I need like 45 minutes, okay?
Put yourself together.
Festival. And now you want me to do that every day. I'm like, no. Like, so the other day, you know, my boss says to me, so I work also full time at a tech company, right? And he said, hey, you know, we're trying to think of new ways to engage our customers since we can't travel now. And we're thinking, hey, maybe we do all of our presentations with our camera on. No. I'm like, yeah, sure. Okay. How about a compromise? How about if we turn our cameras on in the beginning, like to say hello, to greet the customer, like if, you know, it's a new customer, and then we turn it off for the rest of the meeting. That was my compromise. But also what I've done is I just let go of being quote unquote presentable. So as long as like I semi brush my hair and I wash my face, like I'm like, guess what? I'm presentable.
Oh yeah, I agree.
Whereas before it's like full makeup, lipstick, earrings, blah, blah, blah. Like that's presentable to me. But now I'm like, you know what? Let's do this. Let's see what's gonna happen, you know? And that's it. So I've let go of that. And I feel like if we all collectively let go of that, then everyone's gonna have to deal with it. I mean, as long as we're, you know, like you're not in your bra, I love to just be, you know, like that. Or braless, actually. So, you know, we as women also need to let go of some of the expectations that we're putting on ourselves, and then let everyone else deal with it. See, and let the dice fall where they may.
Yeah. I like that. That's so like candid that. And so true. Yeah.
You know, I work for IT company too, right? So, you know, I work probably 60% of my time at home. So it's not a very big challenge because, but the thing is, usually we have conference calls, right? If somebody can't, you know, visit or we just get on a call, we don't need to put a camera on. But now it seems like, oh, we'll be on a Zoom. We'll be on a camera on. I'm like, okay, but that's okay, right? We adopt. And certain times I just, like you said, wash your face and just get on with our life.
What I do want to say is that I, you know, advice for managers, et cetera, and leaders of meetings is to, I've been lucky so far that I haven't been in any meetings where any of the managers or team leads have stopped the meeting and asked people to put their camera on. I've heard of that happening, and I would really advise people not to do that, because you have no idea what that person did to even make it onto the call that day.
Maybe.
I know.
So don't pressure them even more to turn on their camera. Like you have no idea what they're going through.
Totally agree with you.
Yeah.
I actually think it really leads back, you know, all these issues are not new, you know. These issues are all leading back to the way that the workplace is, the traditional workplace is set up, right? It's set up before you get in. It's set up in a structure of mistrust, of infantilizing the worker, of expecting you not to do your job, right? Like, that's how it's set up, that your manager has to, like, you know, check on you and make sure, like, you're doing what you say you're doing.
I know.
Right? Like, that's how it is set up. Whereas if it was reversed and it came in with a level of expected trust, of expected that everyone's going to do their job, then I think it would be more likely that more of us would just do our jobs. Yeah, there's always going to be people who are going to slack off and whatever and take advantage. But I feel like if it was reversed, there would be more people who were even more productive.
I think overall, it is more productive working from home, right? but since we're on this topic about, you know, the working day, how we go through our working day. So it's a question of disconnecting and setting boundaries about working hours. I think we kind of mentioned that, and, you know, getting pressure to work into evenings and weekends these days. And then sometimes, you know, we're home and so can expect us to be available 24/7. So how do you set firm boundaries and still instill confidence that you're getting the job done?
Yeah. Danielle, I'll tell you this. I don't need to revise that during COVID, because I set boundaries from time when I started any job that I start. I set boundaries. Okay.
Yes. And
this is some real shit I'm going to tell you. Okay. And this is specifically for immigrant women, right? Mm-hmm. Because what I've found is that most non-white cultures, we have a very direct way of speaking, right?
Yes.
We're a little bit more, you know, not raw, unfiltered, not abrasive, but it's our culture, right?
Yes.
Whereas white Canadian culture is a lot different. And what I did is that I really sat back and observed this. I started to think, why do people think I'm aggressive? Let me sit back and watch this, right? And I had to adopt, right? Like a Becky persona when it comes to how I say people's boundaries. Okay? So listen to how white women speak in the workplace. I this is no lie. I know it sounds funny, but I really listen, observe, and soak in how they phrase certain things in a way that is so soft, and the other person will be so receptive to it, but it's firm at the same time. And I'm like, we are masters at this. I'm like, I need to learn how to do this. So I observed so many women do this, right? And I said, okay. So, for example, and I remember this happened last year, a colleague messages me at 8 o'clock, right? On the G-chat. Hey, Cam, I need to chat with you. Just something, right? And I respond saying, oh, wow, this must be really urgent if you're messaging me at 8 o'clock. Okay, let's talk. So we get on, and it's completely not urgent, okay? So I shut down the conversation. Okay, let's talk about it tomorrow. And I respond, and he sends a follow-up email, to which I reply saying, this is not an 8 p.m. conversation. Here's what an 8 p.m. conversation looks like. This. If this happens with the customer, if that happens with the customer, that's an 8 p.m. conversation. This is not an 8 p.m. conversation. Mm-hmm. And he said, you know what? You're right. Actually, I think I just got really excited. I got really anxious about what was happening. And I'm sorry, I won't do that again. I said, great. Thank you. You know, whereas before I may have just like blew up on it and be like, you know, like really lost it. Now I'm a little bit more measured, but still firm, right? Yeah. You have to teach people how to treat you. People know, there's a my husband is Jamaican. There's a Jamaican saying, monkey know which street to climb. And there's different variations of this across different cultures, right? And I'll say it again, the monkey knows which street to climb. They know, people know what they can get away with certain people. When they think, hey, let me send this message to, she ain't gonna respond to that, right? They know who's gonna respond, who's not gonna respond, because you have to train them to teach people how to treat you, right? And so I've always done that, put in those boundaries. People know what type of person I am. They know this time with my kids, they know that this is a priority for me, because I say it over and over again. And I think that it has to be women, and especially mothers, we're very hesitant to be transparent about what our priorities are. And because we don't want to be seen as, oh, like your kids are more important than your work. Yeah. My kid at the end of the day actually is more important than this work. Do I still want to be paid here? Yes, I do, sir. Thank you very much for this job. But yes, if I had to choose, it's my kids. And what's interesting is that this pandemic is now allowing us now to, if you grab hold of it, because we're all now quote unquote in the same boat. Now your boss is feeling what you've been feeling all the time, right? All the time you've been having to deal with this, but now they're at home with their kid on their lap now. When you have been all the time breastfeeding a baby while doing a damn conference call from times, okay? But now they have the kid in their lap on their knee, having to bounce the kid on their knee while they're leading a meeting, right? So now they know exactly what it's feeling like now, right? It's allowed them to see that, yes, you're what the real priority is, and that you don't have to hide this anymore. What we were doing before COVID was completely hiding this. So many of us were just, like, you know, yeah, they call you at 8, you got to get on a flight tomorrow. Okay, yeah, I'm there. I'm good. I've done it myself. And I never did that again. Anytime my kids have anything like important I need to attend, I put it in my calendar and I don't shame. I say exactly what it is with my kids. Do not call me. Go attending this recital, Christmas concert. But I put it right in there because really tell me that you want, you're really going to pick up the phone and tell me, hey, I need you to miss your kid's Christmas concert to come to this meeting. You're going to feel like an ass, not me. I just put it all out. That's my advice.
Yeah. Thanks for sharing. I truly enjoyed that.
Yes.
Directness. Transparency. Yes. Yeah. You go, girl.
You know, as you shared that story, I remembered an incident that happened just at the beginning of this pandemic. Mm-hmm. So just like you said, you know, in your story, I was trying to like drop a schedule for the kids, but I had them do it themselves, like to say, okay, this is what you have to do every day. So tell me how you want to do it.
Yeah.
And of course, I was using my office laptop, right? So I was like putting it on an Excel. And at the same time, I was doing some office work. Yeah. So I ended up sending a schedule to my boss. With my kids, exactly. And like immediately I hit the send button. I just sent her a message. I'm like, I'm sorry, I sent you the wrong schedule. That's for my kids, not for you.
I know. But let's say you have your business, your entrepreneur, right? So with that, how do you set those boundaries with yourself?
That's just curious. That's even harder. Doing it for yourself is the hard part. And man, that's something I struggle with. I can set boundaries for other people all day long. But myself, like, you know, even today, my daughter, she was asking me to, I was responding to an email and she was on my lap, like using my leg, my lap as a jumping off platform or whatever. And she's like, no phone. And she just swatted the phone right out of my hand. I was like, oh shit, I gotta stop this. I'm like, really, that I don't have to respond to that email right now. And then I continued jumping with her, you know? But sometimes it takes them really getting my face, like for me to stop, because I take off one and I put on the other. Like I work at a tech company in the day, then I have the buyblocks.com, our online magazine. So I'm constantly editing articles, posting things and posting social media, giving writers feedback, responding to new writers, responding to pitches from PR people. Like it's a whole job, right? So it really does never end. And any entrepreneur will experience that. You always feel like there's something else to do. But you have to remind yourself, like, is this, man, you ain't saving no lives here, right? You're just neglecting your kids. So that's what you do.
Yeah.
So when I just have to have that hard truth with myself, then I got to put it down, you know?
You are career women. You have your own business, have own magazine. You have kids. How do you find time to manage all of that? I know you're dynamic. You're full of energy. But how do you manage that? I'm just curious. Something you can share with all of us.
I'm not full of energy, because if you ask my kids, what does mommy like to do the most? I'm pretty sure they would say sleep.
me too.
I think my kid even wrote that once on a school assignment. I was so embarrassed. My husband has boundless reservoirs of energy. I do not. Find time. This is my Achilles heel, 100%. Every time I get asked this a lot, and I tell you the same thing every time. I don't do it well. I don't manage it well. I don't have a secret recipe for how I do all of these things. I just do it till I have to stop. I do it till my daughter swats my phone out of my hand. I really do. I, and like, you know, I steal like whatever moments of Zen that I can, you know, whether it's like, you know, when they're inside me just going on the back porch in the sun, just sitting there for 5.5 minutes in the sun and be like, okay, I can get back now. But it is so difficult, especially now, because all of your breaks are spent mothering. Like you work and you mother, you work and you mother. That's it. And I don't want to make anyone feel like as if you can do this. Honest to God, you can't do this. Like what we're being asked to do, we can't. Like, and I'm gonna have different levels of breakdowns forever. Like
what's gonna I know. Now working from home is that you're a working woman and you're a mother and you're a chef.
Yeah.
You're a cleaning lady. I'm doing it all right now.
I mean, you know, and I, again, it's the transparency. Like there's many times when I feel bad because there's like my team meeting at work. It seems like whatever time it is, it's always during the time when the house is the most craziest. Mm-hmm. And like today I had the computer, the laptop on, all the people are in the meeting and I'm obviously on mute and my camera is obviously off. 1 minute into the meeting, Roger comes home with my daughter because he just took her to Canadian Tire to buy a helmet. And he also decided to buy them both air horns for their bike. We run into the house. Beep, beep, beep. Like the air horns, two air horns. I'm like, wow. And at the same time, I'm making like chicken fingers and cutting up carrots for this one to eat at the same time. All this is going on at the same time. And I'm trying to listen to the presentation that's going on at the same time. That is just how it's going to be. And I don't want anyone to think that you're going to have, you know what, maybe you do, but I don't have any time for no lavender bubble baths and long walks, all this stuff. Like, I don't have time. I mean, you know, my self-care is, you know, I watch a couple hours of Netflix till like 2 o'clock in the morning until because I can't fall asleep. Not because I really want to, but it's just so stressed out. Like, I can't sleep. You know what I mean? I don't know what this self-care thing really is supposed to look like. I don't know. I don't think I have it, but I've tried. And all I can say is at 10:30 a.m. this morning, I stopped myself from having a glass of wine. Okay. I really wanted to drink that wine after breakfast. And I'm like, Cam, nah, you got to have a line, bro. And I'm like, you can't drink at 10:30. We are not going to do that. So I had a whole conversation about pulling myself back from certain brinks, okay? Like, that is all I can do right now. Like, pull myself back. Like, okay? Mm-hmm. Like, okay, you can do this. You can get through this without alcohol. You can, girl. You can do it. And so I do. So whatever, you know, I can do in that day, like, that's my victory. Like, I didn't drink today at 10:30. Now it's 8:30. I'm about to drink.
Do what's best for you. You know, do what's best for you.
That's my victory. I do not drink after breakfast. Okay? Today. Okay. Tomorrow it'll be something else. I comb my kids' hair. Yes. Amazing. Oh. Victory. That's, you know, that's it.
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about buyblacks.com. So I love that when I was reading your bio on LinkedIn, I see that you describe yourself as a social storyteller.
Yeah.
I love telling stories. I believe strongly in the power of telling a story. And recently I watched on Netflix, Michelle Obama's documentary on Becoming. And I just remembered something, a quote she had given when she was in Toronto. And she said that our words have power when we realize that our stories have power. Mm-hmm. And I just tied that to you and what you're doing, telling stories.
Yeah.
So would you like to share with us what led you to start this online magazine and what kind of stories you hope to tell through it?
Yeah. So Buy Blacks has been around for going on 7 years now. So we're a long ways into telling Black Canadian stories of excellence, of survival, of resilience. We started the magazine. It was the idea for the business was my husband's great genius idea. And he started it as, he wanted to start it as a directory, which we did. So it was a business directory. He thought, let's have a space where Black Canadian businesses can, a central space where they can promote themselves. And then a friend of ours was looking at it and said, hey guys, you know, you need to give people a reason to come back to this. Why don't you tell stories about the businesses? And it was just natural that me being the journalist in the family that I would take over that part of the business. So I became the editor-in-chief and Roger became the publisher. So he deals with the technicalities of the website, mm-hmm. as well as the advertising, all the sales. And then I take on the editorial side. the stories you want to tell, the stories that resonate most, I find, with our audience is, and it really shows how hungry our community is for to understand who we are and where we came from. Any story that we write about that has any historical context about Black history in Canada, and you can see that it's so hidden within our Canadian system as we grow up. We're not exposed to the true story of how Black Canadians came to this country and how they helped to form this country. All we're exposed to is Underground Railroad, and so we should be really grateful that we're here. There's a lot that we're not exposed to. And so anytime we do stories about anything to do with Black Canadian history, it explodes. One of the most successful campaigns we did was the Black History 365, where I came up with this genius idea to do a social media post about a different angle of Black Canadian history every single day for a year.
Wow.
I took this on myself. And every time I thought that I was going to run out of material, there was more. And I found this all online, museums, books, etc. I found this all online. All this information is out there. There's so many scholars and experts, but it's not covered. It's not amplified. And so we work really hard to bring out some of those stories. Like, we're doing a lot more, exploring now a lot more about Afro-Indigenous history. A lot of people don't know about the connection between the Black communities here and Indigenous communities, how our stories are intertwined, how much we helped each other, how much we engaged with each other historically. And so there are a lot of Afro-Indigenous people in Canada that people don't even know that that exists. People are like, that's a thing? I didn't even know that's a thing. And so we hear of the experiences of one Afro-Indigenous man who talked about going to school and having something done to him called a pencil test, where they put a pencil in your hair, and if it drops out, okay, you're Indigenous because their hair is silky. Your hair is Afro, so therefore they consider you Black.
Wow.
And he talks about, you know, what it is growing up half Black and half Indigenous. And it's something, and when I look at the comments that people, they're like, I've never heard this before. I never even knew that this was an experience. On the flip side, we do a lot of stories about business and entrepreneurial success. So we do a lot of stories about Black business owners, like just starting new and different businesses and what they're contributing to their community. So we do focus a lot on positivity, on stories of success. And I think that there's a place for that. There's a place for the stories about, you know, our struggles. But for me, after having worked for 10 years in mainstream media, I grew very tired of overemphasis on our struggles, right? The mainstream manipulation of Black pain was very apparent to me. Right? So mainstream media is all for, if you contact them with the story of that, you know, you're experiencing racism, you're experiencing discrimination, that is very clickable for them. And yes, we do still cover some of those stories, but we focus more heavily on reflecting back to our community, our success, what we have done to make us, you know, remind us that we are part and parcel of this country, of forming this country, and contributing to the success of this country. So I think that part is very important for younger people and for anyone who is experiencing any type of lack of esteem. And I find that that is very prevalent among Black Canadians who were born and raised here.
Yeah.
As opposed to Black Canadians who have immigrated here.
From
a Black majority country, it's a very different experience that you've had. Now, this has led to actually a lot of conflicts, right? Within our community, because you have Blacks who have immigrated here, who come from a Black majority country, and they're like, I don't understand what your problem is. Just get over it, suck it up, move on. Like, what is the problem, right? Like, they don't understand the experience of being denigrated your entire life, of going to school and having great abilities, but being pushed into a particular stream because they just don't think that you can do what you say you can do. They don't have the experience of not seeing anyone in positions of power that look like them. They don't have the experience of having never had a Black figure of influence or power in any of the systems that you encounter. Your entire school life, never having a Black teacher, never seeing a Black male in a position of power that had a positive influence on you, right? These things are life-changing, and they contribute to a feeling of exclusion, right? Mm-hmm. And so, I always like kind of to speak to, because that's my experience. I grew up half here and half in the Caribbean, right? And so I experienced both sides of it. So I kind of sit in the middle. And I really like to emphasize that to my friends who immigrate here from a Black majority country, that you have to sit and educate yourself about the Black Canadian experience, that is very different from your experience. And you cannot sit in your experience and judge them for their experience. Two different things.
I like that you shared that story, because I didn't get that perspective until last year. I moved to Canada 3 years ago from Nigeria. I didn't get that perspective until I went to Africville last summer. Mm-hmm. So my family went on a road trip to Halifax. Mm-hmm. And when I got there and I met people who had grown in the system and hearing their story, I just saw that, wow, even I myself have just one side. Like, I'm looking at the coin from just one side. There are different sides of the story that I didn't have. So I'm glad that you shared that, because it completely resonated with me.
And I see that we cover a lot of things in just the past, conversation about, you talk about the sense of belongings to the community, and you talk about maybe like identity crisis for our younger generations, right, who children of the immigrants. Yep. And as a matter of fact, Camille, I watched one of your YouTube videos about media and publicity. Mm. And you said this, I found it's very inspirational. I really want to share with everybody here. You said, I want to be remembered as somebody who allowed everybody else to tell the truth from their point of view. Mm-hmm. I think that's very important, to share that kind of insight point of view. And just for example, recently I hosted an online charity performance night with over 200 people online with the CCAA, which is Canadian Chinese Alumni Association. It's a nonprofit organization. So the theme is to thank our frontline workers and encourage people to donate and support them. And because of this event, we raised over 10K with a match of Red Cross, right? But the thing is, I realize we don't seem to talk about it outside of the community, right? And then so from your perspective, right? I mean, you wear a lot of hats. You feel a lot of responsibilities in your community. And it seems that core to all of your work, be it at the magazine or Hootsuit, your identity as a storyteller. What advice do you have for women, immigrant women particularly, on using stories to help the community they support?
So first I'll start with a reality check on that first before I answer that. And the reality check is that the world is cruel, unkind, and unfair, especially immigrants. Okay. And the reason I'm saying that is because when it comes to your personal story and sharing that story, right? For it to be received, from what I've observed, you have to have certain levels, you have to have a number of degrees of separation from your story. So when I say that, I mean, for example, if you've just arrived here on day one, right? And you're a refugee from a war-torn country, and you go for a job interview on day two, and you are very transparent about what you have just experienced, right? That may work against you, because nobody really wants to deal with your trauma. Nobody really wants to. Workplaces, right, are not equipped or just unwilling to deal with the trauma that people experience when they immigrate here, refugee or not. There are different levels of trauma that we are all coming here with, right? We love to say how, we're so open and this, and we're inviting, all these people to come, but we do not have the tools to deal with the realities that come along with being a person of color or an immigrant, right? Mm-hmm. And so what we do like is, yes, you came here 3 years ago and now you're a success. oh, now you've written a book. Now you write articles on the CBC. Now you do this, not right? And then these are the stories that make it into mainstream, right? Mm-hmm. That's the reality check I'm going to give you. Mm-hmm. So the reality check I'm saying is that unless, I don't think that storytelling, right, will necessarily work for you if you are a recent immigrant. That's my opinion. I think that you have to play some cards close to your chest at first. You have to gain some level of experience here, like, you know, go through, you know, all of the mental and emotional cycles that we go through when we come here, and gain some level of perspective from your story before you start sharing it. I don't know if that makes sense, if I explain that.
I understand. I understand what you say.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's not a nice answer. I know it isn't, but it's the truth. And that's always what I bank on, right? Mm-hmm. Is the truth. Because that's what I've observed.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of a retelling story, mm-hmm. to pick up some of the, I guess, highlight the stories that people can handle or people are equipped to handle.
Right.
When you go into that reality check, but yeah. Maybe later on, of course, you know, you need to spend more time to observe the culture, yeah. and how to adapt the environment, and then you can carry on. And of course, because I believe anything you do in life will not be wasted.
Sure.
Every time you look back, you look at the mirror, you say, hey, I'm so glad I did that, right? So mm-hmm. I think you're giving us very, very good advice. And I hope all the listeners here are also taking notes, because I'm taking notes. Mm-hmm. And then also, you know, from that video I watched, I also learned something that about yourself. You're mm-hmm. saying this statement with a full confidence. And I hope all the immigrant women, Korean women, should listen to this. You said, I'm a woman of unshakable confidence, but I'm unfinished, who is a work in beautiful progress. And that is beautiful. It's a beautiful, yes. And I was very touched when you said that. This is very transparent and very inspirational. So can you tell us, what's a story about yourself you have shared that you think has been key to advancing your career and personal brand?
Yeah, you know, first I'll say it's hard to pinpoint. I share a lot of stories about my life. And there are a lot of stories I don't share. It's hard to pinpoint which ones resonate, or I have no idea what advancing my career even really looks like, or which ones have advanced. There's no way for me to figure that out. And I don't kind of sit there and look at my life and say, okay, what stories can I share that would advance my career? All I fall back on is truth telling. In whatever I feel that I can share from my life that will help somebody else, that may touch somebody else or resonate with somebody else, I will share. I will share with you an experience of a story that I hesitated to share. When I went to a board meeting in Ottawa, I was invited to sit on the board of the Canadian Foreign Service Institute. And this was a big deal, because it was filled with highly trained academics, former diplomats, really smart people. Right? And they asked me to come on. For sure, they wanted to make sure that they were getting a diverse perspective. And I have a lot of experience in social media, with you know, digital storytelling, etc. And so they wanted to ensure that they had some perspective on modernizing the way that they communicate. But it was a very overwhelming experience for me to sit there with 90% older white men, who, you know, have a wiki trail, right? Like their accomplishments are a mile long. And it was an 8-hour meeting, and for some of the times I drifted out of my body, and I felt like I was a child again, looking out of the window of the apartment that I grew up in on Danforth Avenue, that was located above a Chinese takeout restaurant. And there were often shootings across the street from me at the nightclub that used to be raided. There was a bar next to our house where drunk guys would come and piss on our door overnight. And I have remember images of my mom on her knees on the sidewalk, scrubbing it with bleach. These are the things that I recall, right? And the reason why I feel like I went back to that was because I was so, it was so unbelievable for me to think that I had gone from being that girl to being this woman sitting at this table. It was almost like I couldn't connect. Like, how did I get here? Like, how am I here, right? And it was hard for me to focus on the contents of the meeting because I was so flabbergasted that I was just there. And I was like, okay, so now I want to share on my LinkedIn that I had this experience and I went to the meeting, whatever. And so I drafted it speaking about exactly what I've just told you, about where I came from and the feeling of the representation that I was doing at that meeting, like representing people who have stories like myself, right? Mm-hmm. And I drafted it, I said this to my friend. She's like, yeah, this is great. And I'm like, you know what? No, I'm gonna take this out. And I took out the entire thing and I just had a, oh, had a great time at the meeting and this, whatever. And she was like, you know, stop it. And that's all she had to say to me. She was like, stop. And I was so afraid of being judged. I was so afraid of people mm-hmm. knowing that side of me because I've never shared that side of me before mm-hmm. of how I grew up. Right. Mm-hmm. And I shared it. And I think it is still to this day the most successful post I've ever had on LinkedIn in terms of people's response, not only in the comments, mm-hmm. but people messaging me privately, mm-hmm. very successful people mm-hmm. messaging me with their own stories saying, I grew up like this too. This is where I am now. This mm-hmm. happened to me too. This is where I am now. And I was just shocked at the number of private messages I got from people that this resonated with.
Yeah. Wow.
That's a very good story.
That's such a powerful story. Yeah. Such a powerful story.
Very, very powerful.
Yeah.
Thanks for sharing.
Yeah. And honestly, when I hear you share that, I think I will, your comment earlier to say that storytelling doesn't make a lot of changes. I think what you shared now kind of challenges that. I feel like when we tell our stories, we reveal a part of ourselves that the world has to know. They mm-hmm. might not accept it right now. Mm-hmm. They might not have the capacity to accept or process it. Mm-hmm. But I think that it does put a narrative out there and it does put, it gives us a face out there. So honestly, I'm really touched and moved by this piece that you shared. It's so fantastic. We've had such an interesting conversation with you already, Camille. We started from how you transitioned from working from home with your new coworkers and then just going through this whole process. Yeah, we've taken so many things from you. And one thing definitely I'm leaving this meeting with is just in the power of telling the truth. That's one thing I think that has come through in everything you said. So my last question for you this evening would be, from a perspective of inclusion, what is the one thing that you hope that we all come out from this whole situation with? Like, we're all transitioning into a new form of norm for ourselves. Like, we all know we can't go back to the way things used to be.
Yeah.
There will definitely be a new. Mm-hmm. What is the one thing, what is the one change you would like to see from a perspective of inclusion from all of this?
I think that I hope that what becomes apparent is the way that we traditionally have been doing D&I training in the workplace was seriously flawed. Mm. Now that we can't bring in a speaker to talk at employees for an hour or two and then tick a box, what are we going to do now? Mm. Are we going to realize that these 1 hour or half day training sessions aren't enough? Are we going to invest in continued training, in bite-sized learning that we deliver to people on a regular basis? Or are we going to continue checking the box every quarter? Oh yeah, we did D&I training. I want us to use this as an opportunity not to devalue D&I, because that could very well happen with people saying, oh, well, it's a pandemic. We just gotta think about sales and think about surviving. But you can't survive without people. You have to have the people in order for your business to survive. So if you are a business leader, that is thinking about devaluing your D&I efforts, I say to you, think again. Because you will go nowhere fast without ensuring that everybody really feels like they're in the same boat and they all have the same size oars.
Wow.
And I think that how they treat their employees now will go a long way. People mm-hmm. remember that.
Most definitely.
For a very long time. I think that, you know, I mean, I'm sure there are smart leaders and, you know, smart companies out there. They would do something right.
I hope so.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for being with us, Camille. It's been an honor and I've learned a lot today. So thank you for your time and sharing those beautiful stories with us.
Thank you guys, my pleasure.
An illuminating and necessary talk with Camille.
So much of what she shared feels especially relevant as we work on building more equitable workplaces and a more equitable world.
I hope all of our listeners are encouraged to recognize the power in their own story and find ways to share them. For more about Camille, you can visit her website at camilledundas.com. I'm Chidimma Eghagha.
And I am Danielle Chen. We've been your hosts. Today's episode was produced by Rohit Singh. Our executive producer is Andrea Thompson.
And that was Business of Inclusion. You can tell us what you thought about this episode and what you want to hear from us next on Twitter at TRIEC, T-R-I-E-C, or on LinkedIn at Toronto Region Immigrant Employment Council. Thanks for listening.